Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and on behalf of the Indian Business and Professional Council, I take this opportunity to welcome each one of you to this very interesting session that we have lined up today. We have a distinguished panel of speakers lined up to speak, and I'm sure that each one of you are eagerly looking forward to hear their views. I take the opportunity to welcome His Excellency Sri Shyam Saran, former Foreign Secretary, Lord Karan Billimoria, who has come all the way from London to talk to us, Mr. Yashwardhan Sinha, who was the former High Commissioner. Excellency, welcome, sir. And I also take this opportunity to welcome Suhasini Haider, who has come all the way from Delhi to be with us, and Mrs. Sinha, to have also joined this evening in our get-together. Before we proceed with the proceedings, may I now request our President, Mr. Nimesh Makwana, to hand over a flower bouquet to His Excellency Sri Shyam Saran. Request Mr. Vasu Shroff to hand over a bouquet to Lord Karan Billimoria.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Mr. Saul Agarwal to hand over a bouquet to our Consul General, His Excellency Sri Vipul. Mr. Paras to hand over a bouquet to His Excellency Sri Y.K. Sinha. And Mr. Dawood bin Uzair to hand over a bouquet to Ms. Suhasini Haider. Request Mr. Nimesh Makwana to hand over a bouquet to Mrs. Y.K. Sinha. I now call upon Mr. Nimesh Makwana, President of IBBC, to deliver his welcome address.
Assalamu alaikum, namaskar, and good evening to each one of you. IBBC Dubai always brings very intellectual, topical discussions and sharing of experience by very learned and experienced dignitaries. Today's event, as Krishna Ramachandran mentioned, is very unique and important, since we are going to have discussion on India's foreign policy and climate change, and very important pertinent subject, Brexit, global implications, India and Middle East. We are fortunate to have amongst us today the Padma Bhushan, Sri Shyam Saranji, former Foreign Secretary, Government of India, and we welcome you, sir. Let's have a big round of applause. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and gracing the occasion and with your presence to share and discuss on foreign policies and climate change and its significance in today's world. We are fortunate to have you, sir, and your vast experience in foreign service, which will throw light how India is positioned strongly in foreign policy while dealing rest of the world, and which is evident UAE-India bilateral relationship, which is at golden era. The great supporter to Indian diaspora in Dubai and Northern Emirates, our His Excellency Sri Vipul, Consul General of India to Dubai, and we welcome you, sir, for gracing the occasion, and he is always available for Indian diaspora and contributed significantly to enhance and strengthen India-UAE relationship. Thank you very much, Your Excellency. We are fortunate to have with us Lord Karan Billimoria, Member House of Lords, who is going to enlighten us on Brexit and its implication on India and Middle East. I am sure you all must be eagerly waiting to hear from Lord Karan Billimoria. We welcome, sir. Let's have a big round of applause for Lord Karan Billimoria. The session is going to be moderated by none other, Sri Y.K. Sinhaji, Information Commissioner, Central Information Commission, Government of India, and former High Commissioner of India to the United Kingdom. And we welcome you, sir, and thank you very much for your assistance to have Lord Billimoria to address all of us. So thank you very much, sir. We have amongst us a very prominent journalist, Ms. Suhasini Haider, from National Editor and Diplomatic Affairs Editor, The Hindu, who will moderate the session along with Sri Shyam Saranji And we welcome you also, madam. Thank you very much for gracing the occasion. We have a good senior delegates over here. Business community leaders are sitting here. I'm sure this intellectual discussion will throw a lot of lights and will enlighten with all the dignitaries over here. At this juncture, I must appreciate and thank Ravi Menon also, who has coordinated and helped us for the event. Thank you very much. Now, without taking much of your time, I'll hand over to Krishnan Ramachandran for rest of the proceedings. Thank you and have a lovely evening.
Since thanks are not, I must also take this opportunity to thank the event sponsors, the Sahul Group and Blue Star for kindly consenting to host this event. Thank you, gentlemen, for hosting and for being here with us today. I now call upon His Excellency Sri Vipul, Consul General of India to Dubai, to give his address.
Good evening, everyone. Let me add my words of welcome to the very illustrious speakers that we have with us today evening. Lord Karan Billimoria, CBE of the House of Lords, Sri Shyam Saran, former Foreign Secretary of India and Padma Bhushan awardee, Sri Yash Sinha, former Indian High Commissioner to UK, and more importantly for all of us here, former Consul General of India to Dubai, and Ms. Vasini Haider, Senior Journalist from The Hindu. I heartily welcome all of you on behalf of the entire intern community in Dubai. I also appreciate IBPC Dubai for arranging this program. This is the first time in the last 3 years that we are having a program in IBPC of this quality on foreign affairs. I don't think we ever got speakers of such experience and intellectual depth as we have today. I thank the President, Mr. Nimish Makwana, Vice President, Mr. Krishnan, and all members of IBPC Governing Board for this. As you would imagine, being a member from the Indian Foreign Service, I am particularly pleased and happy to see and meet Sri Shyam Saran and Sri Yash Sinha, who are both my seniors in service and to whom we have always, and I particularly, have looked for guidance. When I joined service in 1998, Sri Shyam Saran sir was our ambassador in Myanmar. As junior diplomats, the first overseas trip that my batch did was to Myanmar under his watch. While I have faint recollection of that visit now, I certainly do remember that he made us understand the importance of our bilateral relationship with Myanmar, a country that straddles critically between India, China, and ASEAN. Later, when I was still a junior diplomat and in media division, he was the Foreign Secretary of India. This was the time when India was negotiating the nuclear deal with the United States, and there were several other challenging issues on the plate, including our perennial, China and Pakistan. Today, having 15 more years of experience in the Foreign Service, I can say that there's not been any Foreign Secretary who could explain the very complex foreign policy issues with such clarity and simplicity as he could. This is also reflected in his book on how India sees the world, where he has dwelt on issues with the prism of both ancient and modern Indian approaches to statecraft. Sri Shyam Saran is a great authority on India's relations with China, as well as with our neighbors. Climate change, nuclear issues, disarmament, of which, sir, I also have a bit of experience, and a lot more. I'm sure we will all benefit from his wisdom greatly today. These are all issues that remain very important for India and the world. Yash Sinha, sir, will be moderating the session with Lord Karan Billimoria on an issue I guess that most outside Britain do not even comprehend the need of. I'm sure he would understand it much better compared to other outsiders, as he has just retired as India's High Commissioner to UK. But sir, more importantly, for all the people present here, you were their beloved Consul General more than a decade back. And sir, I don't think there's been a more popular Consul General than you among the influential Indians here in Dubai. So I keep hearing people's friendship with you, and if I can say, as they say, with Yash and Gigi. That continues to be a constant refrain from all the people here. Yasinasa has also served with great distinction as our High Commissioner in Sri Lanka and headed, besides several other things, the Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Iran division in New Delhi. Lord Karan Billimoria has been passionate in speaking about Brexit, I guess more as a critic, in the sense that it is a choice that perhaps shouldn't have been exercised. I may be wrong in all this, sir. I think as Indians, we should all be very proud of him for three reasons. First, his success as a self-made man through entrepreneurship. I think every Indian has a streak of entrepreneurship in him or her. As the founder of Cobra Beer, sir, you have shown the world as to what Indians can do. Second, his coming from a family of Indian Armed Forces, whom every Indian is always very proud of. And third, of course, due to his success recognized in him being in the House of Lords. I'm sure that with his experience, we will be able to understand what Brexit is all about, its necessity, and its impact on India and the Middle East. Clearly, Brexit is something that will impact all of us, especially those in business, given the integrated supply chains, global supply chains today. As soon as the deal was struck last week, and we have seen that some of it is getting unstuck a little bit today, but there were a number of shares in India that jumped on the stock market, and being saddled with some Tata Motors shares, I also felt happy that for the first time in several months, we had something to cheer about. I would also like to welcome Suhasini. I have known her from my XP days, but as a journalist and columnist, she has deep understanding of foreign policy issues, and that should be on display tonight. Before ending, let me say that despite global geopolitical and trade challenges, if there is one relationship that has continued to do extremely well in the last few years, it has been that of India and the United Arab Emirates. We have a comprehensive strategic partnership, and that goes beyond trade and investment. Such a close relationship means that people living here in the UAE, including especially all Indians, have a great interest in understanding how India views various global issues and developments. I think today's session is very important in that context. So let me end here and extend a very warm welcome to everyone once again. I look forward to a great and illuminating evening. Thank you. I think Krishnan can take over and Suhasini thereafter. Thank you very much.
Well, that leaves me no words to talk about the event today. I think Sri Vipul, has, His Excellency, has summarized the flow of the events. So we have the agenda. We have two, the events is into two parts. One is the session on the foreign policy part, which will be handled by Mr. Shyam Saran and Suhasini Haider. And after that, we would have the talk on the Brexit. To start with, let me introduce our first speaker of the day, His Excellency Sri Shyam Saran. He will first speak for about 15-20 minutes, and after that, we will have an interactive discussion. I do not want to call it a moderation. I think we have, like RCG mentioned, an eminent panel of people around here, so each with their own strengths. So we will have a discussion, and followed after that, we will take up the next session. Sri Shyam Saran is a career diplomat born in September 1946. Since joining the IFS in 1970, he has served in several capitals of the world, including Beijing, Tokyo, and Geneva. He has been India's ambassador to Myanmar, Indonesia, Nepal, and High Commissioner to Mauritius. In the Ministry of External Affairs, Sri Shyam Saran headed the Economic Division and the Multilateral Economic Division, and also headed the East Asia Division, which handles relations with China and Japan. As a joint secretary in the PMO's office in 1991-92, he advised the Prime Minister on foreign policy, nuclear and defense-related issues. After a career spanning 34 years in IFS, Sri Saran was appointed India's foreign secretary in 2004 and held that position till his retirement from service in September 2006. Subsequent to his retirement, he was appointed Prime Minister's Special Envoy for Indo-US civil nuclear issues and later as Special Envoy and Chief Negotiator on Climate Change. He concluded his assignment in government and returned to being a private citizen in March 2010. During his last two assignments, Sri Shyam Saran served as Prime Minister's personal representative, or Sherpa, at the Glen Eagles and St. Petersburg G8 plus G5 summits and was present at the Tokayo and L'Aquila summits as an advisor on climate change issues. He also attended the Pittsburgh G20 summit as a member of the Indian delegation. Sri Shyam Saran was chairman of the National Security Advisory Board under the National Security Council from 2013 to 15. He served as chairman Research Information System for Developing Countries, which is an autonomous think tank specializing in studies on economic trade-related issues from January 2010 to 17. He is also a senior fellow of with the Center for Policy Research, a prestigious think tank which covers a wide range of political, social, and economic issues, including foreign policy-related issues. He is also a member of its governing board. Recently, Sri Shyam Saran became a life trustee of the India International Center. He speaks and writes regularly on a variety of subjects. His book, How India Sees the World, was published in September 2017. On 26 January 2011, Sri Shyam Saran was awarded the Padma Bhushan by the President of India for his contribution to civil service. The Padma Bhushan is the third highest national award in the country. In May this year, he was decorated with the Order of the Rising Sun, Gold and Silver Star by the Emperor of Japan. I now welcome Sri Shyam Saran to address the members of IBC. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And thanks to all of you for not just bringing us here to Dubai, but to actually coming and listening to us speak about what I know is a subject that, whatever you might think of everyone's views, it's a subject that is much loved. And I don't think that there can be a greater exposition, if you like, on the love that someone has for the foreign policy of India and for just, you know, the understanding of its nuances than Ambassador Saran's book. The truth is that I have read this book not once or twice, but several times. And even while I'm reading a book, I sometimes go over one or two chapters more than once. But as you speak about how India sees the world, and you know, we think of the world changing every second. The Hindi word "shan bhangur," which is that it is the world seems to be destroyed in every second, and sort of rebuilt and recast, if you like, all the time. The truth is that there are some truths to India's foreign policy and India's posture towards the world that have remained constant, and I think that's one of the things your book tries to tell us. But answer for us that question then, when you say how India sees the world from Kautilya to the 21st century, because this is also one of the biggest criticisms of India, of India's foreign policy, is there a strategic policy to India? Does India have a strategic posture?
Well, thank you, Suhasini, and it's always a pleasure to have you as an interlocutor. Let me also express my gratitude to the IBPC, Mr. Bhakwana, Mr. Ravi Menon, and all the other office bearers, and all the very distinguished people who are present here this evening. I really appreciate the fact that all of you have come this evening to have this interactive session. Of course, I would like to also recognize the Consul General in Dubai, Vipul, who is also a old friend and colleague, and also Yash and his wife. I know that they have been here as Consul General in Dubai, and as has been pointed out, very much loved here. But he also has a certain family connection with me, which I will perhaps maybe tell you later on. But it's always a pleasure to have him at these gatherings, because he has a great reputation as a diplomat, and has been recognized by the government by making him an information commissioner. So I'm very happy to see you here. And Lord Billimoria is, for a short time, he did not recognize me, I think, this evening. But I think we also go a long way. We met quite some time back, and we have been meeting off and on. So I'm very happy to see you, and very honored that you are here also this evening with us. So to answer Suhashni's question. Why did I write this book of how India sees the world? So partly to respond to the charge that you drew attention to, that is a sense that India does not really have a strategic culture. India's foreign policy is a very reactive foreign policy. You know, it always responds to events that are taking place. There is no big picture, there is no frame of reference in terms of how India conducts its foreign policy. Some would say that India as an entity is actually a modern construct. I mean, the British say that India was actually created by them. There was no such thing as an India in the past. And when I started looking at some of these issues, one, of course, is the fact that perhaps some people are not aware that India as a political and a geographical entity actually is older than China. So if you look at the first centralized empire in history, it is not the Qin Empire in China, it is actually the Mauryan Empire in India. Or at least 100 years before that first empire in China. And if you are talking about the geographical dimension of India, one of the very interesting things I found is that if you just plot all the different, you know, edicts of Ashoka, or, you know, the pillars, Ashokan pillars, on which you have inscriptions by Emperor Ashoka. If you just plot it on a map, you will see that it almost traces the geographical spread of India. So this is something which perhaps many Indians are also not always aware of, that actually you are a legatee of a very, very ancient civilization. It's not that it is a new geographical construct. Actually, it is a very old construct. So that is one point. Second is the issue of strategic culture. Does India have a strategic culture? And here again, even I was not perhaps as familiar. One had heard the name of Chanakya, but I was not really aware of what Chanakya was all about. What was, you know, the Arthashastra all about? And if you go into Chanakya's treatises, you actually find that you have perhaps a far more elaborate, far more sophisticated, you know, statecraft, which goes back more than 2,000 years, in many ways, it still is a kind of frame of reference, whether we are aware or not, a frame of reference through which, you know, India looks at the world. This is very important. And just to bring home that point, I wanted to just point out that, you know, these days, people talk about comprehensive national power. That, you know, today's states, which are powerful countries, powerful states, they have various attributes of national power, which makes them a great power. And if you look at what Chanakya has spelled out as the various attributes of great power, one is political leadership, or what Chanakya calls Swami. That is, unless you have wise leadership, that you cannot really be a great power. Or he says that you must have good governance, based on really whether or not the leader has the ability to choose the right kind of counselors. So what he calls amatyas. So unless you have around you people who can give you good advice, people who are good counsel, again, it is very difficult for a leader to really aspire to great power. The other is, of course, not every country can become a great power. It must be a country which has vast territory. It must have a large population. Those also are attributes of great power. Or, of course, it must have a very flourishing economy. So that is what he calls kosha, or like treasury, that you must have a strong economy in order to be a big power. Amongst the other aspects, of course, are defense, fortifications, which he calls durg. Unless a country has good defenses, it cannot be a great power. It must have good allies. It must have good set of countries with which it has very good relations. So that is Mitra. I'm just mentioning these to you because many of these things will appear to you very contemporary. And here you are talking about a theorist who lived more than 2,000 years ago. So there is a certain relevance to even these principles, even in a world which has changed so much. As I said, whether we are conscious of it or not, in many of the things that we do as diplomats, we are, in a sense, consciously or unconsciously responding, in fact, to this particular frame through which we are looking at them. I will not go into other details because we can talk about contemporary issues. But when we are looking at the world, and in particularly this particular region, I believe that there is a certain consistency. I mean, every leader who comes wishes to distinguish himself from his predecessors. And yet you find that there is a certain consistency, there is a certain ground reality that you cannot get away from. So in that sense, even though Prime Minister Modi is seen as being a very different kind of leader from before, perhaps with a personality which is, again, quite different from his predecessors. But even there, I find that there are consistencies. People ask me sometimes, in what way do you see Prime Minister Modi different from before? Maybe there are two or three characteristics which are somewhat different. One is that here is a leader who has great sort of belief in personal diplomacy, leader-to-leader engagement. That a lot can be achieved in today's world by having that kind of very personal chemistry, personal relationship with his counterpart leaders. You see that here in this part of the world. I mean, he has just managed to establish very, very strong personal relationships with some of the key leaders in this region. And that has stood us in very good stead. Second is that even though earlier leaders have emphasized the importance of the diaspora, people like you who are gathered here, the role that the diaspora can play in the promotion of India's economic interests, in the promotion of the familiarity that people in other countries may have of India's culture, of India's people. The role of the diaspora was recognized, but I would say that it has reached a very different level altogether under Prime Minister Modi. Looking at the diaspora, and members of the diaspora as all being, in a sense, representatives of India, diplomats, representing India. That's an important change. And the third is a great emphasis on how to promote India's economic interests. In this respect also, the importance given to economic diplomacy is also something perhaps a little more than what we have seen before. And that too, I would submit, is very, very apparent in India's relations with this part of the world, including the United Arab Republics. So these are nuances, but I think it would not be correct to say that earlier leaders did not recognize the importance of this region to India. So consistency, yes, but also certain nuanced changes. I think I will stop here and maybe I can respond to it.
Okay, it's certainly interesting, and I was crossing over because I think you took away my first four questions here. But the truth is you did talk about this consistency, and yet we do see changes in India. We have shed, if you like, the idea of non-alignment or being an active member of the non-aligned movement. We have shrugged off, as Prime Minister Modi said during a speech in the United States, the hesitations of history, the idea that we will be in one corner of the world and not aligned with others. There is a talk about a new India, a new era that is coming out. At the same time, everything you've said is about an India standing in the world. But the world kind of stayed the same for a long time, at least 70 years of the post-World War, what was called the Western Liberal Order, seems to today be completely in flux. We're seeing competing things happening. There is the rise of China, which of course you've written not one but two chapters about. There is the retrenchment of this Western order and a reduction of American power as a result of it. I don't like to use the word decline of American power because America has proved us wrong time and time again on this score. And then there is the success of this populism around the world. And I don't think anyone is untouched by it. It's in democracies, in republics, in kingdoms around the world, the idea that there is a new there's no other word for it but populism, of people taking over many of the critical foreign policy decisions that are happening. How does India actually balance through all of these, in particular deal with the rise of China at the same time as you deal with the retrenchment of the world order? Is India ready for the role or leadership role that is required?
You mentioned that there has been a very major change in terms of, for example, how India narrates its relationship with the rest of the world, and you mentioned non-alignment as being something which has undergone a change. I mean, people may say non-alignment is now outdated. Now we are in a world of maybe multi-alignment, or even if we are not going into alliance, but we are going into very strong partnerships. There are various ways in which people describe the shift. My view is somewhat different. Of course, there will be changes in the manner in which you relate to the rest of the world, because the world itself is changing, so things cannot remain the same. Much more importantly, India is getting transformed. So if India is getting transformed, it cannot be relating to the world in the same manner as in the past. But I think there is an underlying principle which we have not moved away from. If you look at how Jawaharlal Nehru articulated India's foreign policy, what was the most important element? That India was a civilizational state, that it was always a country which thought of itself as having a major place in the world order, that its destiny was to emerge as a major power, or even a great power, that India had to stand for something more than just itself, and a certain larger sense of humanity, a certain larger sense of responsibility to the rest of the world. So, according to the principle that he adopted, it was that India should be able to, especially having come through a very painful colonial experience, being an independent country and very zealous of being an independent country, that India, having emerged as an independent power, it should be in a position to take relatively independent decisions, relatively autonomous decisions on issues which are of vital interest to it. Not on every issue. Not every issue is a vital issue. Not any country, even the greatest country, cannot be fully autonomous or fully independent. But I think the principle which he laid down, that India as a civilizational state, India as a great power, should be able to take relatively autonomous decisions on issues which are of vital interest to it. Those decisions should not be taken in other capitals of the world. Now, if I look at this principle, which may have been described as non-alignment in the past, is it any different today? I would say perhaps this principle is being followed even more zealously than it was, say, 50 years ago or 60 years ago. So in that sense, I see a thread which continues to be relevant. Now, it is this principle which is also, I think, an important guide in terms of how we relate to the flux that you're talking about. There is a geopolitical change which is taking place. I would look at the change as not necessarily something which is negative. Because when things are frozen, you know, there is a rigidity in the international system, as it was during the Cold War. You had a binary in terms of the East and the West. Spaces for emerging countries are somewhat limited. It is only in times of change and very, very big changes as are taking place that spaces are there for you to be able to expand your interests, expand your status. And so India in that sense has a great opportunity that this change of flux in the international system is offering India's opportunities to actually expand its own strategic space. Yes, there is the issue of, you know, how does India relate to China? And it is a big challenge because China is today, if we look at, say, 10 years ago, people used to talk about Chindia. That is, China and India are more or less in the same league. That is not being talked about. Let's be honest about it. Because today China is seen as being five times the size of India. But what is perhaps different today is that this gap seems to be increasing. So you are faced with a huge asymmetry of power. And how you deal with that becomes then very important. Now, what India has been doing, and I think is a wise kind of policy, what India has been doing and has to do is, number one, the first order of business is how do we begin to shrink that asymmetry? Because unless India gets back to, this is my belief, unless India gets back to 8%, 9% rate of growth over a long period of time, it will not be able to shrink. So that's very important. All that you need to do in order to really expand your economic capabilities and through that, of course, your other capabilities as well, your ability to deal with this asymmetry will be limited. In the meantime, you have to find ways in which you counterbalance this challenge. So in that, what we are doing is we are trying to be part and parcel of countervailing coalitions, as I call them. So whether it is our relationship, very strong relationship, or even partnership with the United States, with Japan, with Australia, with Southeast Asia, countries in this region as well. The deeper the relationships we have, the deeper the partnerships we have with other major powers, that gives us a certain degree of heft in dealing with China. But at the same time, with China itself, there are issues on which there are some convergences. Like I mentioned to you that there is a certain space which has developed because of the flux. In many ways, the change in the global order that China wishes to see is also what we wish to see. Whether, for example, it is a greater say in international institutions like the World Bank or the IMF, they do not reflect the current balance of power. So in some senses, India and China have certain common interests. You know, for example, when I was negotiating climate change, the most important, in a sense, partner or ally that we had as India was China. You know, we had the similar kind of interest. So let us try and see whether there are convergent interests on which we can work together. We are two of the largest economies in the world, so there is a certain complementarity in terms of, you know, economic opportunities, commercial opportunities. Can we work on them? But at the same time, ensure that we have the means, the capability to be able to confront China wherever there is a kind of a unilateral assertion of power or where our interests are being harmed. So what you see in terms of, say, the Wuhan summit, or what you now see as the Mamallapuram spirit, I think it is that constant balancing of, you know, a certain cooperation as well as some confrontation. And I think this probably will continue.
Right. And there are some amazing anecdotes in the book on climate change negotiations, which are worth reading, about how India managed to maneuver between the US and China. And at that time, certainly got the strongest position as a result of that. I want to ask you a little bit about what you just said on, you know, finding countervailing situations to China. Last year, I was in Xinjiang. And one of the things that that I saw, and I think we discussed this once, was this train that was being inaugurated. The train had maybe 100 bogies behind it. And it had a big red bow on the front of it. The big red bow was because it was the first train that was going to go from Xinjiang, the Xinjiang capital of Urumqi, which is a land port, to Naples in Italy. And it was carrying, I found out, these entire 100 carriages was carrying one single product, tomato ketchup. Now you think about what that means for the world, that we are now living in a world where not only is China able to send 129 trains every week between ports in China to ports in Europe alone, 6,000 kilometers running a train line, which is essentially taking what one would think is coals to Newcastle. You know, I mean, how have the Italians been having their pasta, pomodoro all this time if it wasn't with, you know, some sort of tomato sauce over there? But now China is producing it for them. It also tells us, in a certain sense, because we don't have a railway line even cutting across right now the subcontinent. It also tells us a little bit about the disparity in power. Instead of choosing to become a part of that, India decided to take its own course. In fact, battled the Belt and Road Initiative on the world stage. It has found some allies over the last few years. But the question really, should India be looking right now at taking China on, or doing maybe more of what Deng Xiaoping used to talk about in the early 90s, the quiet rise, work on India's own economy? Where do you see the choices?
Well, on the Belt and Road, which is a very, very ambitious and I would say quite a unprecedented kind of a global project. So in its design, it is certainly very ambitious. But I would caution you in terms of, you know, perhaps being taken in entirely by what we see as, you know, these connectivity projects that China is putting in place, because the fact is that these cargo trains that we are talking about through the Eurasian corridor, it is still very, very heavily subsidized. So the Chinese calculation is that even though this heavy subsidy is being given, over a period of time, this will actually become, in fact, with the density of traffic and with improved technology, it will probably become, in fact, a good alternative, a feasible alternative to the sea route. China is looking at it also from a security standpoint, because it knows that its main lines of communication, sea lines of communication across the Indian Ocean, South China Sea, in fact, it is vulnerable. Therefore, having an alternative across the land corridors is something which makes sense, but it is not as yet economically viable. But that is something might change. I think India does not have, to my mind, any major issue with the Belt and Road, except that in its design, India did not have a part to play, which is a big difference from another project which India has happily joined, which is the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, for example. In the design of the Asia Infrastructure Bank, The way it is structured, its lending policies, its shareholding pattern, in all this, India had a very important role to play. And India is, as you know, is the second most important country in that. It's the same thing with the BRICS Development Bank. In fact, I think an Indian is the president of the... In these cases, it was truly a multilateral institution in the design of which India had an important role to play. When China asked us to sign on to the Belt and Road, this was our response. That instead of this being a Chinese design project which you want me to sign on to, why are you not ready to sit down together with us and with other partners to see how this could be designed? So that, you know, if there is a port to be developed in Indonesia, what are the ways in which we can actually work together in order to bring this about? Rather than be told that, you know, this is what we are going to do, take it or leave it. Now, China tried to change this somewhat by saying, well, you know, this kind of consultation can take place in the future. But, I mean, that's not quite the case. So if India looks upon itself as a genuine partner of China, and I think it would have no problem in doing that, having that principle followed, I think is a good principle for India to follow. That you should not take it for granted that you, because you are China and you have designed it, therefore everybody has to sign on the dotted line. No, I don't think so. Having said that, we have also conveyed, both at Wuhan and I would imagine at Mamallapuram, that irrespective of this principle stand that we have, if there are specific projects which make sense for both of us to work on, we have no problem with that. So it's not as if it's an either-or kind of situation. And there has been a vagueness, you know, I mean, there is a history of India and China working together on projects, for example, you know, oil exploration in Syria or in Venezuela or in Sudan. So it's not something that we have not done before with China. So going forward, if there is, as I said earlier, that if there is a certain convergence in terms of interests, I think India will take a fairly pragmatic view on that cooperation.
Where it's possibly not so easy to take a pragmatic view is when it comes to China in our region, what we see as our backyard, the subcontinent. And you mentioned the Mamallapuram summit. Straight after that, we saw Chinese President Xi Jinping go and make that first visit to Nepal. There weren't big announcements made out of it, but the message was very clear that China was now sees itself as a subcontinental power. You mentioned Kautilya, so I will quote Machiavelli to you. My question, how does India deal with this presence in its region? Is it better to be loved or to be feared? Is it better really to look at our traditional ties and keep talking about those traditional ties to our region? Or do we have to now match China, in a sense, dollar for dollar? And finally, can India, you know, you spoke about India rising to this place in the world and taking its leadership in the world. Can India be a world leader without carrying the entire subcontinent with it?
You know, I have said this number of times before. If India does not get its own neighborhood right, then it's trying to play a regional role or a global role will always be suboptimal. So the first order of business is getting the neighborhood right. And it is true that rhetorically at least, not just Prime Minister Modi, but his predecessors also, did say that the first priority of India's foreign policy is in fact the neighborhood. The problem is that that has not always been translated into actual policies. What is the kind of human resources and material resources you are ready to deploy in order to give a sense of reality to what you are saying, that this is your first order of priority? So this, I think, is something that you have to address, you know. And let us be clear. If you're going to leave open spaces, somebody will walk in. So it is important for you to make certain that you don't create those spaces for somebody to walk in. Now, in terms of how do we deal with the neighborhood, You know, like any good businessman, you say, okay, what are my assets? What are my liabilities? The assets, to my mind, are that the very asymmetry that India enjoys vis-a-vis its smaller neighbors is, in this sense, a great advantage. Because with kind of a dynamic economy that you have, if you adopted the right kind of policies, you could become the engine of growth for the entire subcontinent. You are in a sense naturally placed in that situation. But in order to be able to do that, you have to have very different kind of economic policies. You said that while China is building these railways across 6,000, 7,000 kilometers, subcontinent today, even today, is not as connected as it was in 1947. Now, if that is the case, then should it come as any surprise that your relationship with the neighbors is not as strong as it should be? In fact, India has to be in the lead in trying to bring about dense connectivity with the rest of the subcontinent. That is very important. Secondly, India's market is a huge market compared to the neighbors. Even if you said, I am prepared to let you sell whatever you wish, whatever you produce, you want to sell in India, you can sell in India. It will still be a small part of your economy. And yet you have, various kinds of restrictions on really expanding trade. That has to change. You have to make that choice. Third element is, take just one issue that we keep raising about transit. Oh, the Bangladesh is not giving us transit into the other part of Northeast, or Pakistan does not give us transit to Gulf or to Afghanistan. But the biggest transit country in the subcontinent is India. Are you prepared to say, offer national treatment to your neighbors as far as transportation across India is concerned? If Nepal wants to, use any highway in India or any railway line in India, any port in India for its trade, okay, why not? Your leverage over your neighbors should actually be that you are the most competitive, most convenient transit country for all your neighbors. Why should it be that Nepal should be looking at China as an alternative for its trade? When I was ambassador in Nepal, I would always try to tell the Nepalese that you are not India locked, you are not landlocked, you are India open, because you have an open border with India, you can do whatever you like. So I think in terms of what are the ways in which you can confront what China is doing, these infirmities in your foreign policy have to be addressed. Without that, it would be very difficult to do that. Great advantage that you have is proximity. That you are, if you had the right kind of connectivity, you would be perhaps the most competitive source for a lot of the trade. Secondly, you have very, very dense cultural affinity with all these countries, which China does not have. Are you prepared to be able to leverage that? These are the ways in which you can confront this.
All right. I ask the next question with a little bit of trepidation, because it seems to be a lost cause. And by that, I mean India's ties with Pakistan. The question, since we are doing things differently today with Pakistan, in terms of we've seen this the sort of crossing over the LOC, which was publicly announced in 2016, the bombardment of targets in Pakistan this year. The question that we will not speak to Pakistan until terror ends, that certainly is perhaps, as you said, a continuation of what we've seen for the last decade. But it's also treading into new waters where I think, in fact, Ambassador Sinha will probably be one of the last who can remember going over to Pakistan for part of the composite bilateral dialogue. So the question is, are there new ways in which we can look at this seemingly intractable problem, or do we just hunker down and wait until a time when Pakistan changes? Is it time to listen to some of the voices in this region, actually, that have said maybe we should be open to third parties being involved? I'm putting these ideas out there simply because it seems as if we've reached a place where the key has turned in the lock and the door of engagement is permanently closed.
So when I said that unless you get the neighborhood right, the regional role that you aspire to or the global role that you aspire to will always be suboptimal. And when I say getting the neighborhood right, getting Pakistan right is equally important. So you cannot think in terms of a successful neighborhood policy unless you manage also the relationship with Pakistan. Now, there is hostility of Pakistan that you have to confront. I'm not saying that, you know, suddenly one day you will have a grand reconciliation, but I think it is very important that the adversarial relationship that you have with Pakistan needs to be managed. That is, you certainly have to confront the security challenge that you face from Pakistan. But I don't think that we should, over an extended period of time, end up with a situation where there is actually no engagement. And don't be surprised then if people say that maybe you need mediation, which we are very allergic to. So if we are allergic to that, then I don't think we should create a situation where people feel tempted to intervene. Now, in that sense, even though it may appear to be somewhat difficult to envisage that there could be resumption of dialogue, I see no alternative at some point for India to engage with Pakistan and for Pakistan to engage with India. Again, it has been my view that the more difficult a relationship, the greater the need for engagement, the greater the need for dialogue. And I think with respect to Pakistan, in terms of how we eventually manage the neighborhood, excluding Pakistan or looking at, for example, South Asia saying minus Pakistan, to me, it is not a realistic way of looking at India's interest, but perhaps this is a minority view.
Okay. I'm being told we're quickly running out of time, so if I can just look around the audience and take a few questions before we have to wrap up this session with a show of hands. Is anyone who... Why don't you start?
I think we had a wonderful dialogue on the global outlook. As we can see, that China has clearly kind of tilted the race in its favor. And as per the IMF, as per the purchasing power parity, it's already the largest economy in the world. India and China pretty much started very similar with the huge populations, but China has taken the lead in a different way. India has certain advantages like the IT industry or whatever. Where do you see that India can have an edge over the others, especially with the USPs that India has, like the soft power and things of that sort?
Can we take one more question?
Sure.
Because we're done. There was a hand up, I saw.
Just one more question before we wrap up.
Go ahead.
Good evening, sir. You said that India has allergy to third-party mediation for Pakistan and India neighborhood. What do you think India should go for third party mediation and why?
No, I do not think that India needs to have a mediator in trying to resolve issues with Pakistan. I think it is in our interest that whatever outstanding issues they are, we should be able to deal with those through a bilateral dialogue. But that bilateral dialogue has to take place before we can do that. So that engagement is something that there is a certain contradiction. If we say we cannot accept third party mediation because all things should be resolved bilaterally, but then if we are not having a bilateral dialogue, then there is a certain contradiction there. So it is very important that we eventually have to engaged with Pakistan in order to deal with outstanding issues. But I'm realistic enough to recognize that at this particular point of time, with the, in the backdrop of the events that have taken place in the recent past, it is very difficult to see a resumption of dialogue currently. I mean, it will probably take a little time. And with regard to your question, there are many assets that India has, you know. But I think much of what India needs to do depends upon our own, you know, policies, what kind of policies we adopt. So one of the things I always point to is that, you know, if you look through history, any major power which has arisen after being able to borrow from the knowledge, most advanced knowledge, most advanced technology, whichever are the current centers of wealth and power. Okay. So if you look at, say, the Roman Empire, they built it on the basis of whatever they were able to absorb from the Greeks. Or when the Arabs were ascendant, they got knowledge from Central Asia. Central Asia itself got knowledge from India and from China. So this is a kind of a pattern in history. What did China do from 1978 onwards? Like a giant sponge, it absorbed knowledge, technology from wherever it could get it. Of course, utilized the geopolitical advantage it has because of the Cold War. US was looking for an ally and China was able to fulfill that role. But the most important thing is that during this 30 to 40 year period, China in a sense had a certain modesty, a certain humility, of being like a student and absorbing, you know, beg, borrow, steal, whatever, to make itself the great power that it is. In India, you need that kind of a modesty, that you also need to be able to absorb the most advanced knowledge that you have anywhere in the world, because that is the basis for power. Without that, power is not going to be yours. So there are things that you need to do. We should be proud of what we have achieved, for example, with our space program. But you know, islands of excellence should not remain islands of excellence. Unless islands of excellence become continents of excellence, it is very difficult to see ourselves rising. That kind of a change in mindset has to come. That's my view.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I would say topical and happening as we speak. The topic that we are going to discuss is about Brexit, a term that we have all been hearing for so many years now. And apparently a decision has been taken, we just heard, just before this session started today. And to take over that session, we have two eminent speakers with us, Lord Karan Billimoria and Sri Y.K. Sinha, who would take over the session in a few minutes' time. Before that, I would like to briefly introduce both our speakers for the benefit of our members. Lord Karan Billimoria is the founder of Cobra Beer, chairman of Cobra Beer Partnership Limited, a joint venture with Molson Coors, and chairman of Molson Coors Cobra India. In the Monde selection of one of the most prestigious quality awards in the world for beer, the Cobra range have collectively been awarded a total of 111 gold and grand gold medals since 2001, making it one of the most awarded beers in the world. Lord Billimoria is the founding chairman of the UK-India Business Council, a deputy lieutenant of Greater London, a former chancellor of Thames Valley University, now the University of West London. He was the youngest university chancellor in the UK when appointed. Lord Billimoria was the former senior non-executive director of the Bruker Group, now Tesco PLC. He is one of the two visiting entrepreneurs at the University of Cambridge. He is a founding member of the Prime Minister of India's Global Advisory Council. In 2006, he was appointed the Lord Billimoria of Chelsea, making him the first ever Zoroastrian Parsi to sit in the House of Lords. In 2008, he was awarded the Pravasi Bharati Sanman by the President of India. He is an honorary fellow of the Sydney Sussex College, Cambridge, and chairman of the advisory board of the Judge Business School, Cambridge University. He qualified as a chartered accountant with Ernst & Young and graduated in law from the University of Cambridge. He is also an alumnus through executive education of the Craneford School of Management, the London Business School, and the Harvard Business School in July. And in July 2014, he was installed as the 7th Chancellor of the University of Birmingham, making him the first Indian-born Chancellor of a Russell Group University in Great Britain. And he is the President of the UK Council for International Students Affairs. Since 2017, Lord Billy Murray has been a Bynum Tudor Fellow at Kellogg College, University of Oxford. Lord Billy Murray is an Honorary Group Captain in 601 Squadron of the Royal Air Force. In 2019, he was appointed Vice President of the Confederation of British Industry, CBI. May also take this opportunity to introduce the second speaker along with him, Sri Yashwardhan Kumar Sinha, a seasoned diplomat, and during a career spanning of 37 years, he has handled several important assignments at the Ministry of External Affairs, New Delhi, and in Indian diplomatic missions in South Asia, the Middle East, Europe, South America, and the permanent mission of India in the United Nations in New York. He has held the rank of Secretary to the Government of India at the time of his superannuation from the IFS in October 2019. He was sworn in as Information Commissioner in the Central Information Commission, New Delhi, on January 1, 2019. So his career spans, he was the High Commissioner of India to UK from 2016-18. Before coming to UK, he was Commissioner of India to Sri Lanka from June 2013 to 16. Prior to this, he was Additional Secretary and headed the important Pakistan-Afghanistan-Iran division at the Ministry of External Affairs, New Delhi, for almost 4 years. Mr. Sinha has represented India at numerous international and regional conferences and meetings. In addition, he has participated in various bilateral, regional, and multilateral talks, conferences, and seminars, including the South Asian conferences organized by the International Institute of Strategic Studies at Muscat in 2009 and 12. He's done his master's from Delhi University. He joined the IFS in 1991. He was the member of the Secretariat of Non-Aligned Summit held in New Delhi in 1983 and the CHOGM Summit held in the same year. He has a diploma in Arabic from the American University of Cairo. May I now request both the distinguished speakers to join on stage and take us through the next topical discussion of the evening, Brexit.
Thank you, Mr. Ramachandran. And at the outset, may I like to thank IBPC for organizing and hosting this event. Also, special thanks to Mr. Ravi Menon, who sort of conceptualized this, and he's been trying to get this together for quite some time. I'm happy that Dubai, a place where we all talk commerce, is also looking forward to interacting with eminent people. And of course, you heard the previous session, our former Foreign Secretary, Mr. Shyam Saran. From what he spoke, you would realize that he's perhaps one of the most cerebral Foreign Secretary we've had. In fact, if I may just share very briefly, that I was very keen to join the army because both Karan and I have an army background. But the diplomat who had the most impression on me was Mr. Saran when he was a probationer in 1970. He used to stay on Kasturba Gandhi Marg, at that time Curzon Road, and in Delhi. And I had come from school. I was in boarding school in Bihar, in Patna, and I had come on a holiday. And I met him, and I think that had a lasting impression, and that's perhaps why I chose the life of a diplomat over a soldier. I don't know whether I did the right thing or not, but I certainly don't regret my choice because I was very happy joining the diplomatic service. If I was given a choice, I'd do it again. But I'm very happy to have Lord Billy Murray, and Karan for me. You know, you'd be surprised that our families have known each other for a long time, but I never met him. I met his mother, was his father, and his very eminent father, and his brother, but never him, till I reached London 2 years ago. And when I met him, I realized, obviously one had heard about him, he has done so well that the diaspora in India, the Indian diaspora in the UK has done so well, but Karan in particular. And I'm very happy that next year he will probably take over as the President of the Confederation of British Industry. And if I see the representative from CII, they have an institutional relationship. But having Lord Billy Murray heading CBI, I think it would be excellent for India-UK, the India-UK partnership. And of course, apart from the fact that he's one of the founding presidents of the UK-India Business Council, roughly, well, not exactly an equivalent of IBPC, but doing similar work. And I found the sort of legacy that he left behind there made the people like me who followed in London as High Commissioner make my task much easier in dealing with the UK business and the general scenario post-Brexit referendum. But before I get into that, I just thought I'd also like to thank all of you, especially some of my old friends. There's so many that I won't recount their names. It's such a pleasure coming back to Dubai. For me, I left Dubai when I was working here 13 years ago, almost exactly 13 years ago. I did come back a couple of times, either on work or on a brief holiday, but the last time I visited the city itself was 9 years ago, and I think it has changed tremendously. I mean, the business bay didn't exist, and I certainly would have got lost in that area if I drove around now. But my wife is very happy to be back. In fact, as I keep pulling her leg, that she has many more friends than I have, and she's in Dubai. She's a far busier person while visiting Dubai than I am going to be the next couple of days. But I think it's wonderful to be here. Now, I think as far as the topic is, and I think we must, the paucity of time, get on to the topic itself, I think it's important for everyone. I know in India, when people used to ask me, how is Brexit important for India? You know, whatever happens to Great Britain, let it happen, and that's between Europe and Great Britain. But in this globalized world, I think everybody gets affected. I mean, today, if some of you were watching BBC, you would realize what happened. There was an amendment. The Prime Minister wanted the deal to be passed through the House of Commons, and I was wondering, Karan's lucky, probably go back when the House of Lords debated it, but it wasn't put to vote. The deal that he had struck with the European Union was not put to vote because there was an amendment introduced by a Conservative Party senior member, Sir Oliver Letwin, basically requiring that the enabling legislation be put in place first before the deal is voted, which is basically postponing the vote on the deal or the Brexit itself, maybe. But I'll let Karan dwell on that in greater detail. But I'd just like to mention that the UK has been a reluctant participant in the European project. And you must understand that emerging from the calamitous world wars, the two world wars, Europe decided that cooperation was obviously better than confrontation. So way back in 1951, the Treaty of Paris set up the European Coal and Steel Community. The UK refused to join. In 57, when the European Atomic Energy Community, and then under the Treaty of Rome, the European Economic Community came into being, the UK started seeing the benefits of cooperation, of getting together with the continent in a common sort of endeavor for mutual prosperity. But it was only much later, because they tried twice in the 60s to join the EEC, but they didn't succeed. It was only in 73 that they joined the European Economic Community. And then, and this is why I'm making this point, 2 years later, Prime Minister Harold Wilson called for a referendum on whether to remain or to leave. So they were already contemplating exit 2 years after joining. Of course, in that referendum, the Remain side won handsomely. And after that, there have been constant opt-outs, whether it's of the common currency, whether it's on the Charter of Human Rights, or whether it is the justice legislation, and many others. There have been carve-outs for the United Kingdom within the EU. So what I was trying to say was that it has been a reluctant member of this whole project, and certainly member of the European Union, but not everybody. Over the years, there has been a vested interest, and the benefits of cooperation and being a member are for everyone to see. In fact, again, I'll request Karan to, because I know his personal views, and which are not personal really, because he's made some eloquent speeches in the House of Lords. I would recommend that some of you could get through to the Hansard, which keeps a record of his speech, of all the speeches made, and you will find Karan's speeches very clear on Brexit and what he thinks should happen. But of course, I'll leave that to him to speak about. One last point. I mean, there was something about the implications for India and, of course, the Middle East. As I said initially, Brexit impacts everybody, some directly, some not so directly, some immediately, and some later on. But I think the UK, even though it is not the power that it was, say, 50 or 100 years ago, is still an important member of the international community. It's an important economic power even now. London is among the leading global financial centers. So I think the UK's importance should not be underestimated. Of course, as far as India is concerned, it is perhaps the 17th largest trading partner of India, but one of the largest investors into India. Since 2000, it has invested, British companies have invested over $26 billion in India. So it's the fourth largest now, because Japan has recently overtaken the UK, and I suspect because the UK is too occupied with Brexit. But I think it is important to realize that India and UK, it's not just a one-way street. India is the fourth largest investor into the UK. 800 Indian-owned companies, or Indian companies, you call them that, have employed over 105,000 people in the UK, and Indians are the fourth largest investor into the UK. So they play a very significant role, whether it's automobiles, of course, the Tata Group is one of the largest foreign job creators in the UK. But India occupies a very important position, and that is why after Brexit, and I do recall it, I think it was 17th of January 2017, when Prime Minister May made a famous Lancaster House speech, she identified India, United States, China, and Japan as countries that, outside Europe, that a global Britain would like to engage with. But I'm not going to go into too much detail. We'll probably talk about that later. But Karan, I'd like you to, if you could shed some light on what is happening. But before I pass you the mic, I want to end on a humorous note. When I came back from London, somebody sent me a WhatsApp message, and that was a definition of Brexit. And that definition said, the undefined being negotiated by the unprepared for the benefit, for achieving the unspecified for the uninformed. With that,
Yash, we only met relatively recently, but it's as if we've known each other all our lives. And that is because our families are so close. His father was same regiment as my father's 5th Gurkhas. His father was head of the 5th Gurkhas. My father followed and was head of the 5th Gurkhas. His father was head of the Gurkhas in India. My father was. His father was an army commander. My father became an army commander. So he comes from a very illustrious Gurkha family, and I'm proud that I come for the same. So we're friends from the time we met. And of course, Gigi, his wonderful wife, who's here as well. And there's one thing very apparent this evening that you've probably seen, that we are really privileged in India to have some of the finest foreign service in the world, because they're an elite group. Vipul, I met Vipul when he was literally chief of staff to Sushma Swaraj. Now, you do not get to be chief of staff to the foreign minister unless you're the best of the best. How many serving foreign office service are there at any one time in the world from India? How many? A few thousand? How many? 700 or 800. That's what we're talking about for 1.3 billion people. So these are the elite, the best of the best. And it's quite apparent. And also, Mr. Saran, Shram Saran, we've known each other from when I started the UK India Business Council, the Indo-British Partnership, going back 16, 17 years is when I first met you. And you can see how sensible, how amazingly cerebral, as Yash said, and you've seen for yourselves this evening, and we've all learned a great deal. You spoke of Chanakya. Of course, Chanakya was grandfather of Ashoka, the great Mauryan Empire, in the 3rd and 4th century. But I've got a little, I'm a Zoroastrian Parsi. And Cyrus the Great was there in the 6th century BC. And the first Bill of Human Rights was not the Magna Carta, it was Cyrus's cylinder. And I'm so proud of the Parsi community. Mayor Basania is over here, who heads the Parsi community. She does wonderful work for the Parsi community, the World Zoroastrian Congress here. So, no. And it's remarkable that my little community, it's 150th anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi's birth this year, in fact, this month. And he said the Parsis in numbers beneath contempt, in contribution beyond compare. And we're less than 100,000 in the world. And in India, sadly, 55, 56,000 out of 1.3 billion. But yet I'm proud to say everyone knows who a Parsi is. So, and India gave us a home, and it's been our home for over 1,000 years, and we're first and foremost Indians, and proud to be Indians. And Mr. Saran also spoke about the diaspora. You know, the Indian diaspora, 30 million strong around the world. We are now reaching the very top in every field, in every part of the world, and no greater than in this region right over here, with the Indian community doing so very well that I've seen firsthand. In the UK, we now have the Home Secretary is an Indian. There are 3 Indians sitting around the cabinet table, and it's not long before there'll be an Indian who'll be Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. One other mention, while I'm here, I will, of course, do Cobra Beer business. But I'm also wearing another hat, and we have one of our Pro Vice Chancellors from the University of Birmingham, Tariq Ali. Where is Professor Tariq? He's over there. He's one of our Pro Vice Chancellors. And Birmingham is the first Russell Group University, that's the British equivalent of the Ivy League, with the first Russell Group University to set up a campus here in Dubai. And we're building a state-of-the-art campus. It'll be ready in 2021 for 5,000 students. And I'm going to be lecturing at the campus tomorrow, the temporary campus. The students have started a year ago, and we're really proud to be over here. So now, to get into Brexit. how does one get into Brexit, this topic that everyone looking from around the world says, this great country, the United Kingdom, what are you doing to yourselves? And Yash has made a very important point. The UK may only be 1% of the world's population, 65 million people. But it is still the 6th largest economy in the world. If I'm not mistaken, India has just overtaken the UK in absolute terms to become the 5th largest economy in the world. So you have these two countries, one 1.3 billion, one 65 million, one very young as a country. India is a very young country, ancient civilization, but as a democracy, 75 years old. And the UK is seen as the mother of modern democracy and parliaments. And it is still, no empire, one of the largest economies in the world. The UK is G7, G20, permanent seat UN Security Council, still a member of the European Union, and one of the major players in NATO. So the UK is no longer a superpower, but it is very much a global power. And from Mr. Saran's talk, is India a global power? Question I ask, will it be a global power? Well, I think it will be a superpower. When is the question? So when it comes to Brexit, why did we do this? And if we go back, Suhasini, I haven't mentioned you. She's known my brother since they were teenagers. And her father was one of the most famous Indian High Commissioners to the UK, Salman Haider, who I've known when he was Ambassador to Bhutan. Again, outstanding officer. So Mr. Saran spoke about, and Swash, about protectionism. And I just want to, before diving into the discussion, at Harvard Business School, our professor in the January, I've been going there for 16 years, and A professor in January showed us some graphs after Trump in January 2017 and after Brexit. And I'm not exaggerating, the fault lines were identical. Pro-immigration, anti-immigration, rural, urban, educated, not as educated. Every one of those fault lines, you could say somebody for Brexit would be somebody for Trump. So how has this come about? How has this protectionism come about? And he showed us a graph that I will never forget. And the graph started in 1815 after the Battle of Waterloo, where the Duke of Wellington defeated Napoleon. And after that, it brought peace to Europe for 100 years. And he showed a graph of globalization. And at that time, globalization was really low. And then the graph went up and up and up over the next century when the empires of the world, like the British Empire, Belgian Empire, German Empire, they were all built, and you had globalization. And the globalization peaked in the 1900s. And then what happened? The First World War. A war that should never have taken place. If you read every history of the First World War, that was a completely unnecessary war. It was a horrible war for 4 years. Globalization plummets. Then the Second World War starts because of the First World War. In between, globalization picks up a little bit. It plummets after the Second World War. And then you look at the graph after 1945 to today, and globalization is today more than it was in the 1900s, early 1900s. And what happens next? It's history repeating itself with what is happening next. And we've got to nip it in the bud, and Brexit is very much exactly that that is happening. So now we can go into the discussion.
Thank you, Karan. And I forgot to acknowledge the Parsi in you, but I'm glad you did bring this out. And I did mention the Tata Group, which is the biggest investor in the UK, at least from India, doing extremely well. Karan, how would you define today's events? Because obviously there was a pushback within the Conservative Party. David Cameron's, one of his ministers, I think, Sir Oliver Letwin, this amendment I thought may not pass because it was obviously a clear attempt to delay Brexit itself. And obviously the cross-party, there were sort of murmurings that, you know, it's better get done with it rather than keep postponing it. On the other hand, there was a view that a bad deal or no deal should be avoided. And certainly a no deal is an obligation of law now. How do you see things proceeding from here? Because if he doesn't send, Prime Minister Johnson doesn't send that letter to the EU, would he be violating law? I know I'm putting you in a bit of a spot because you are sitting here and not in London, but it's interesting because on the 31st, if they don't ask for an extension time, then the UK crashes out without a deal, and that would be catastrophic. And also, if they do ask for an extension and Europe turns around and said, no, you've already got enough time, I doubt whether they'll do that, but at least that's what they're saying. They're not going to renegotiate the withdrawal agreement. But I think for the benefit of everybody, if you could talk us through what is the withdrawal agreement, and then what is the trade relationship going to be or negotiated during that transition period? Thank you.
So if I just go back, I taught a master class at Cambridge University, the Judge Business School, where I chaired the advisory board. I was asked to do a master class on negotiation theory with Brexit as a case study. So it's basically how not to do it. Yeah. I mean, if you look at this from, we were a business audience, I mean, how many of you are in business or entrepreneurship or professionals? Everybody here, just about, yeah? So negotiations, we negotiate all the time. Now, if you go back to when the vote took place, and Yash Sinha mentioned the first, you know, we don't have referenda. In India, you don't have referenda. In a first-past-the-post democratic system, you don't have referendum. They don't work. Because a democracy is meant to be dynamic. A dynamic democracy means that you get a chance to change your mind. So you vote somebody in, and 4 or 5 years later, depending on the electoral cycle, you get a chance, if they haven't performed, or if they've deceived you, or if they've lied to you, or if you just don't like them, or you like the other person better, you can throw them out and bring somebody back in. And that's a dynamic democracy. In a referendum, you make a result, and that's permanent. And look back at history, at the people who've used referenda. Very dangerous things to use that have had dangerous outcomes. So we've only ever had three in the UK. One was the one that Yash spoke about in 1975, 2 years after we joined the European Community, as it was called in those days. Do you want to stay? 67% was the result. Now here's the thing with hindsight. I put my hand up, I'm guilty. In Parliament, we passed the Referendum Act before the referendum as a simple majority. Now if you want to change the constitution in India, any written constitution, not just India, any written constitution around the world, on the whole, you need a two-thirds majority to change it. Why didn't we say there should be a supermajority? We didn't say it. The next referendum that we had in the UK was in 2011, when they said, should we change from first past the post to an alternative voting system, which many countries have, proportional representation? We decided to keep first past the post by around 67%. And this is the first time you've had a referendum where the result went against what Parliament itself felt was the right result. Over two-thirds of the MPs wanted to remain, and over 75% of the House of Lords members wanted to remain, and the public voted 52-48 narrowly to leave. What do? You have to respect democracy. And here we are, 3.5 years later after that result, and I'm still meant to respect that democracy of a very narrow result where the whole demography has changed. Our birth rate in the UK is 800,000 a year. Now you do the sums, 800,000 multiplied by 3.5 years. It's almost 3 million youngsters who were not old enough to vote, who are now old enough to vote, including two of my children, who say, it's my future. Why don't I have a say in this? And by the way, on the flip side, our death rate is 600,000 a year. You do the sum, 600,000, 3.5, you've got 2 million people there. 80% of the old people voted to leave. They're up there. Now, you just do the sums. 2 million that side, 3 million this side, 80% of 5 million. You've got 4 million difference, and the referendum was won by a difference of 1.2 million. And the youngsters didn't turn out to vote 3.5 years ago. They didn't take it seriously. Now they're saying, damn, we should have been there. They'll turn out in droves. But what has happened on the flip side is now 3.5 years later, the whole country is fed up. Everyone is just saying, just do it. I call it the Nike Brexit. You know Nike, the sportswear. Nike's slogan, just do it. I call it the just do it Brexit. Just do it. You in Parliament, you're useless. Why haven't you done it? Even business in the UK, and I'm Vice President of the CBI, our membership, 190,000 businesses we speak for, their attitude is very much, please do a deal. Please do a deal. Get rid of the uncertainty. But here is the irony of it all. The way, to answer Yash's question, Article 50 was designed, and was designed by one of my colleagues in the House of Lords, Lord Kerr. Lord Kerr wrote Article 50. And he said, when I wrote Article 50, it is if any country wants to leave the European Union, you have to give 2 years' notice. And that 2 years means you continue to stay in the European Union for those 2 years, and in those 2 years, you negotiate your future relationship with the European Union, and then in an orderly fashion, you leave and everyone's friends and everyone's happy. We'll never stop a country from leaving. But this is like Hotel California. Yeah? You can never leave. Now you can check out any time. Now, that is a reality of what has happened over here, because what has happened in those 2 years is first as the European Union has had a very clear mandate from 27 countries. And in negotiating, you know one thing. The person across the table you're negotiating with, has that individual got a clear mandate? I tell you, with Barnier, 27 countries, from tiny little countries to giants like Germany, have had a very consistent mandate. And yet the UK, the ones who want to leave,
It's not a very clear mandate at all. It's a split country and a split parliament. And then the Europeans did a very wise thing. They set the sequencing. And again, in negotiations, if you set the sequencing, you start to control things. And they said, look, what we'll first do is we'll have three things agreed, and then we'll decide on our future. And the three things we'll agree are money. £39 billion is the figure that's agreed. Now, by the way, what's £39 billion? A lot of money? Well, the EU and the UAE do over £50 billion or euros of trade every year. Every year. The UK is a £2 trillion economy. The amount we pay into the European Union every year is £8 billion a year to be members of the European Union net. That's 1% of our government expenditure per year. Now, those of you who are chartered accountants in this room like me, we have a concept called materiality. It's an immaterial figure in the bigger picture. So the £39 billion for a 40-year membership is an immaterial figure in the long run. The next thing was the rights of citizens, the 3 million who live in the UK from Europe and the 1.2 million who live in Europe from the UK, that their rights be protected. Of course, you can't play with people's lives. You can't use them as bargaining chips. That's been agreed. And then the Achilles heel of Brexit, nobody spoke about in the referendum, Northern Ireland and the backstop. That became the conundrum. And these three things we've been stuck with all this time. What about the trade? What about the movement of people? What about the security? What about the space? What about medicine? What about all the things of our relationship? Nothing has been agreed at all. Our security relationship is so intertwined, there is one criminal database that the UK police look at, which is shared with Europe, 500 million times a year. Now, what if we don't have access to that? So our national security is at stake, let alone people's lives and businesses in a seamless single market and a common market. So this is what we start with, where Lord Kerr says, you put the cart before the horse. You've literally done things the wrong way around. You're negotiating these three things, and the main thing, you haven't even started negotiating. And now, if we leave the European Union on the 31st of October, we're no longer members of the Parliament, we're no longer members of the Commission, we're no longer members of the Council, we have no say at the table. And we're then meant to negotiate this future relationship, which we're given until the end of next year to do. And trade deals take many, many years to do. So this is a conundrum that we're now, the uncertainty actually begins. If we leave on the 31st of October, this withdrawal deal is actually only the end of the beginning.
Thank you, Karan. I think that was very important to highlight that the real game hasn't begun yet. And on the 31st, if there is no deal, as I said, it could be catastrophic. I remember reading reports that Scotland will run out of medicine, essential life-saving drugs, in 3 days, perhaps exaggerated, but gives the picture. Dover Port would close down in 1 week, and there'd be long lines of lorries and trucks, freight trucks, blocking the highway. Airports would be jammed. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people here go to London, and as non-EU citizens, you have to wait hours, maybe sometime a couple of hours at Heathrow, to get through immigration. Imagine if the whole of Europe was also put in that line, it would take the whole day perhaps, unless there were sort of expansions done, and it obviously can't be done overnight. But I'm trying to, we also try and understand the sentiment behind the Brexit, the Leave campaign, basically anti-immigration. But on the other hand, it is ironic that the UK economy survives on migrant workforce. Whether it's the hospitality sector, the manufacturing sector, you name it, NHS, the National Health Scheme, 25% of the doctors and paramedics are from India or Indian origin, and of course if you combine Europeans and others, it's probably much more. So how do you reconcile this contradiction between what the economy requires and what is the perception among the older generation in the rural areas, perhaps who voted to leave, because there is no jobs that are being threatened really. Some of the jobs that the migrant workforce is doing, the British have given up or are not doing it. So it's not that they're replacing Britishers, but the perception is that they're somehow affecting the quality of social service, whether it's NHS or others. So there is this contradiction. How do you explain that?
And it's very much a contradiction, and it's not rational at all. A lot of it is to do with emotion. I remember listening to an interview on Radio 4, BBC Radio 4, and they were interviewing a farmer in a rural area in the east of England, which had one of the highest voting areas. They voted over 80% to leave. And this farmer had hundreds of Romanian workers from Eastern Europe, from the EU. So they first interviewed the Romanian workers, one of them who spoke very good English, and said, so are you happy here? Well looked after, very happy. Have you ever had any English workers with you? Yeah, we had one. He lasted one day. So the interviewer said, then she interviewed the owner of the farm. Very well-spoken chap. Are you happy with your Romanian workers? They're very hard-working, they're excellent. Have you ever had any English workers here on this farm? Oh yes, we had one, he lasted one day. So which way did you vote? To the owner of the farm. He said, I voted to leave. She had to muffle her laughter. Why? Sovereignty. Now you see, but if you, this is a very serious point. This concept of sovereignty, that in some way that we are being ruled by Europe, and that we are, they're colonizing us, and that there's ever further unification, that there's going to be a United States of Europe soon. And they're taking money from us, and their laws, and the migration, to Yash's point. At that time, in 2015-16, sadly, the migration crisis was at its peak. You know, the boatloads coming across the Mediterranean, those very tragic pictures. That was, at that time, at its peak. Migration was a fear. And they said, all these people, Angela Merkel agreed to let in 1 million refugees, if you remember, from Syria. And they said, oh, everyone's going to end up in the UK. And you know, this is all misconception, and today migration is not such a big issue at all in the UK. Not at all. And the sovereignty issue, I've been in Parliament for 13 years, the laws that we make that affect our day-to-day lives are made by us in Westminster. The European laws that come to us, we've been analysed, only 5% of them do Britain disagree with, and most of the 95% we've written, we've actually written the European laws. And with the European Court of Justice, the ultimate court of appeal, very few cases go there. Most of them are resolved by the Supreme Court in the UK. And the ones that go there, the country that takes the most cases to the European Court of Justice, or the UK, and we win them. So this concept of being ruled is absolute misconception as well. So what do you do when people have this feeling that they've lost their sovereignty, they've been controlled? A United States of Europe is never going to happen, by the way, because to have a truly federal United States like we do in India or in the United States of America, you've got to have common foreign service, common defense, common central bank, common currency, and the ability to set interest rates. That's not going to happen in Europe. And by the way, we've always had, as Yash said, we've had our cake and we've eaten it too. So we're members of the European Union, but we're not in Schengen. You know the Schengen visa? Every European country except UK and Ireland. We're members of the European Union, but we're not in the Euro. By the way, the Euro is a disaster. One size cannot fit all when you do not have a proper federal system. You cannot have the same interest rate and the same exchange rate for a country like Greece as you do for Germany, and we saw with the Eurozone crisis. We're in Europe, but we drive on the left-hand side of the road. We're in Europe, we measure our petrol and diesel in liters, but we measure our roads in miles. They can't force us. With my beer, I sell Cobra beer in bottles in the supermarket shelves in liters. And I pour my pints in the restaurants and the bars in pints. They can't force me to pour it in liters. So we've always had our cake and eaten it. They can never tell us what to do. European army, there'll be a European army. We don't have to. We've got out of further unification. We've got a veto. If we leave, we lose all that right of veto. And I think we've had the best of both worlds, and we've benefited so much from being members of the European Union. In the spring of 2016, before the referendum, we were the fastest growing economy in the Western world, at the top table of the world. And I just think what we've been going through is just so unnecessary.
Thank you, Karan. I think we're standing in the way of dinner, I think, so we'll try and wrap it up. But I just wanted to make a couple of points. One, of course, you're absolutely right about what UK was and what it is becoming now and this decision regarding Brexit. But to be the devil's advocate, even Europe loses out because the UK is one of the major powers in the EU. And that is why perhaps the EU, or at least the major powers, Germany and to some extent France, have been slightly more accommodating, if I can use that word. But obviously Europe loses too, but UK loses more of that, as you very aptly described. But two things. One is the Irish backstop. Everybody knew that if you leave the EU, the Good Friday Agreement will unravel simply because you are creating a physical border. So Theresa May tried very hard to work around it. The current deal that the UK, that Prime Minister Johnson has negotiated is very much like Theresa May's drafts that were voted down thrice, I think, by Parliament. But the only difference in what I see is that the border now is somewhere in the Irish Sea. And this whole thing about exporting or sending stuff to Northern Ireland, bound for the European Union, you pay whatever duties, etc. It's going to be a nightmare for customs officials without physical checks to do that. And I remember Arlene Foster, when I had visited Northern Ireland last year, mentioned this technical, I mean, Theresa May also had, and I have visions of technical checks being done, but not physical checks. But in effect, what's happening, hard borders are coming, whether it's in the Irish Sea or on the ground. So that is one. And the last point I wanted to make, and I'm going to combine it because of shortage of time, so you can take both, which will interest the audience, is the India-UK relationship. I touched upon it initially. If there is a hard Brexit, and I hope there isn't, but if there is, there is a huge opportunity. And even if there is not a hard Brexit, but a staggered Brexit, and etc., there is an opportunity. It's a challenge for us and an opportunity. So do you see an FTA, especially because of issues that you and I were pursuing on visas and the more liberal visa, student visas, and I'm glad that the what you fought for, the post-study work visas, two-year work visas have been restored. But there's still a long way to go. And India's interest, obviously, is free flow of professionals and experts and IT specialists, etc., so that Mode 4, which is WTO, which basically defines that, is also implemented. And the UK has a problem because of the anti-immigration sentiment that you referred to. So how do we reconcile that? So two questions, Irish backstop, and India-UK.
I'll try and answer them. The Irish situation, by the way, people, again, I don't know how many of you are aware that just 100 years ago, Ireland was part of the UK. So you come to the House of Parliament, in the central lobby, you have the patron saints of Ireland, Wales, Scotland, and England, because it was part of the UK. And when Ireland got its independence in 1921, the UK kept Northern Ireland. So this whole term, United Kingdom stands for Great Britain and Northern Ireland makes up United Kingdom. Great Britain is England, Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. And the border there, it's not a straight line, by the way. It's a very squiggly border in the north of the island of Ireland, which has over 270 crossing points. And at the time of the IRA troubles, and I was there as a student in the UK, there were bombs going off, people being killed. You lived in fear. It was horrible. Tony Blair, when he became Prime Minister in 97, in 98, they had the Good Friday Agreement. We just celebrated 20 years of peace, brokered by the Americans. And the first thing they did was stop all those checkpoints, 270 checkpoints with rifles pointed both ways. And today it's a seamless border. I've been many times between Northern Ireland and Ireland. It's a frictionless, seamless, you just walk across, you don't even know you've crossed into Ireland. Now, if we leave the European Union, that becomes the border between the European Union, the physical border, and the UK. And here's the irony of it. Northern Ireland voted to remain. Scotland voted to remain. Wales narrowly voted to leave, and the UK, England, narrowly voted to leave. So how do you have one part of the UK being treated separately from the other? And that's why Theresa May, this backstop came about, not treating Northern Ireland separately and yet maintaining the Good Friday Agreement, so you have this free flow of people between North and South in Ireland. This deal is putting a border down the Irish Sea and Northern Ireland being treated separately to allow that free movement of respecting of the Good Friday Agreement, but very complicated customs and VAT rules between the rest of the UK and Northern Ireland. With the earlier backstop, if after all these negotiations, if they go on for the next 10 years, in a debate I spoke in this week in the House of Lords, the Permanent Secretary of the Treasury, the Finance Ministry, he's now a Lord, former Permanent Secretary, the Dukun Rusham Saran in the Finance Ministry in the UK, he said it's going to be 10 years of negotiations. Yeah, these trade deals take a long time. How long have we been trying to do a EU-India trade deal? It's well over 10 years. They don't happen overnight. Okay, hopefully it'll happen quickly if it does. So if you've got this uncertainty, the backstop said that the whole of the UK would stay in a customs union and you'd protect the Good Friday Agreement and no other part of the UK would be treated separately from the other part. So one of the dangers of Brexit is it not only is the uncertainty going forward, not only would it weaken the UK but weaken the European Union, it could potentially lead to the split up of the European of the United Kingdom itself. Because the Northern Irish at any time can decide to join with Ireland and become one country. At any time they have the right to do that. And Scotland is now saying, the Scottish National Party that's in power wants independence for Scotland. And they lost 45-55 a few years ago. Now they're saying, give us another chance. We don't want to leave Europe. We'd rather be an independent country and stay in Europe. And what will you be left with? Then Wales will say, we want to be in. And then we'll be left with England on its own, a greatly diminished country that is still a global power today. So this is the danger of what, I hope it will, none of this will happen, but it is very serious. And to your second point, between the UK and India and this whole concept, I think that we've had a very bad period when Theresa May was Home Secretary and then Prime Minister for a total of 9 years. We had a very hostile migration policy, including towards India. I've been a big open critic of it. The moment she has left, by the way, we've brought this 2-year post-graduation work visa has been brought back in for international students, including students from India. And already many universities, I don't know the Birmingham statistics, but the inquiries from India have shot up because the ability to work for a while after you study is very important to international students. So I think that hostile migration that was there for 9 years is now history. I think the current government are going to be Boris Johnson and his government are very pro-business and they will be migration friendly overall. Now, how you deal with the EU migration, if you'd asked Dr. Tariq Ali in Birmingham University, over 20% of our academics are from the European Union. Out of the 450,000 international students in the UK, 130,000 are from the European Union. In the public services, the National Health Service and care sector would collapse without the Indian doctors and the European Union citizens who work over there. The construction sector, 200,000, and I could go on. So the opportunity going forward, could we do a free trade deal between the UK if it leaves and India? Of course we can, but it would have to address the movement of people as well. Indian IT workers, Indian students, families. At the moment, there's discrimination. The Chinese, you get it for £80, a 2-year multiple entry visa for business and tourist visitors. The Indians pay 4 times that. And I've been fighting to say, why should India be discriminated against? We should be paying the same £85. They still have not listened. So you think India's going to do a free trade agreement unless, if you discriminate in that way? Obviously not. So it's not just the tariffs, it's not just the duties, it's about people as well. But I think it is possible and it can be done. And over here as well, the EU and the GCC came very close to an agreement, 2010, I think. I don't see why that can't happen again. And the UK has very strong links in this region, very well respected in this region on every front. And I don't see that stopping. So the bottom line is, with business, we adapt or we die. So if Brexit happens, we will adapt. And we will have to make the most of the situation. And Britain, by the way, I want to end on this very positive note. This tiny country, Britain, you know, it never ceases to amaze me about how this little country, how does it still, with no natural resources, what has it got? North Sea oil and gas is diminishing. It's got nothing in terms of natural resources. 65 million people, small island. And yet you look at whether it's the accountancy profession, lawyers, the financial services, Yash said, top two in the world along with New York, our museums, our music, rock, classical music, jazz, you name it. Film. When are the Oscars without British actors winning or British directors winning? Architects. Manufacturing. 10% of our GDP, but world-class manufacturing, including beer. Aerospace. Automobiles. You name it. Britain is phenomenal. Our universities are the best in the world. Which university has won more Nobel Prizes than any in the world? Not an American university. Cambridge University, 117 Nobel Prizes. Birmingham University, 11 Nobel Prizes. You know, we are phenomenal as a country, this little country, the United Kingdom. So I have great faith in the UK. And India will be, is a global, emerging, economic superpower.
Thank you, Karan. If I may have the last word, Boris Johnson, when he was Foreign Secretary, said, I want an FTA with India. Because whenever I visit my relatives in India, he was married to, as you know, Sir Charles Wheeler's daughter's mother, India, Kushwant Singh's sister-in-law. So, of course, they are now separated and about to be divorced. But he would say that I have to carry Scotch whiskey for my Punjabi relatives. And I'm only allowed two bottles, those are the Indian customs, and if I buy there in the market, I have to pay 150% duty. So I want that duty to go down. And hopefully it'll go down for Cobra Beer too, once an FTA is had. But thank you so much, IBPC and Mr. Makwana and Ramchandran and Krishnan and colleagues, and of course Ravi, for having us here. It was really wonderful being here with old friends. I hope you enjoyed listening to the very eminent speakers that we've got today, and also because the very topical subject that they were addressed. And I'm personally delighted to be back amongst you. And thank you. And before I end, Vipul, my colleague, who's the Consul General here, you're doing a splendid job too, I heard, from the time that I've been here. And thank you so much for all the assistance that you provided all of us and logistics. And of course, Suhashni's company, we were on the same flight. I remember when your first visit to Pakistan, when your father-in-law's foreign secretary called me and said, discreetly check on her. And I don't know how to do check on her. But anyway, thank you so much, and thank you, Father.
Thank you. Thank you very much. May now call Mr. Sahul Agarwal to please come on stage to present a memento to Lord Karan Billimoria. May request Lord Billimoria to come on stage, please. I call Mr. Abbas Ali Mirza to please come on stage to present a memento to His Excellency Sri Y.K. Sinha. And finally, may call upon Mr. Dawood bin Wazir from Blue Star to please join us on stage to give a memento to Ms. Subhashini Aider. Thank you, Mayor. Request all the speakers to please join for a group photo, please.